So I thought I'd set the record straight about what asylum seekers are actually entitled to, as Katie Hopkins, a woman whose legal analysis is famously and expensively unreliable, has been standing in front of a Union Jack to rehearse the myths about refugees coming to the UK in order to get benefits. Sorry, I don't have a Union Jack lying around, so I'll have to make do with this. Okay, so what do asylum seekers actually get? Well, first of all, they're not allowed to work, so any resources they do have are likely to deplete quite quickly. And while Katie is right that they do get £37.75 per week, what she fails to mention is that this is only for those assessed as eligible. So is that everyone? Absolutely not. In order to qualify for National Asylum Support Service, or NASS support, you have to show that you're destitute. Destitution means you have absolutely nothing. No friends who can support you, no family who will send you money, no assets, and obviously no income. So you make your application, you are then entitled to Section 98 support. That is, you go into a hostel while your full application is considered. You don't get to choose whether you get a hotel, B&B or flat. You go where you're put. Say your application is successful, you then get Section 95 support, and that is the £37.75 per week. Oh, extra £3 a week if you're pregnant. That money is put on a special card, which you can then use to withdraw cash, but that money has to cover food, clothing, toiletries, travel to the Home Office or to your lawyer, everything. At the same time, you will be dispersed. Dispersal means that you will be put on a bus and taken to accommodation outside the South East, the provision of which is mostly contracted out to G4S and Serco. A recent parliamentary publication recorded that this is often substandard, unsanitary, and in some instances unsafe to live in, with vermin, damp and leaks particular problems. And this has been a persistent problem since 2001. If you want something to get outraged about, be outraged about this. Private companies, repeatedly bailed out by the government with your money, are profiting from housing refugee families in conditions which would disgrace a Victorian slum. That takes you to the decision on your claim. And if your claim is refused, then there is a possibility of getting what's called Section 4 support. Now, this is not automatic. You must show not just that you are destitute, but also that you are taking all reasonable steps to leave the UK. Fine, although what about those whose claims have been wrongly refused? It does happen. Numerous people are recognised as refugees only after a fresh claim is submitted. Now, it seems improbable, doesn't it, that anybody would leave their home country, their family, all that is familiar and dear to them, in order to live off £37 a week in a leaky hovel. And it's improbable because it is fundamentally untrue. The reason refugees come to the UK, given by nearly every refugee I've spoken to in the last 16 years, is that they believe the UK respects human rights and will make a fair decision on their claim. At FiLiA, we stand with refugees and against racism. It is fanciful to believe that making more refugees destitute will improve the lives of former service personnel. Withdrawing NASS support will only create a public health crisis amongst refugees. If the government can afford to bail out G4S with your money, then they can afford to accommodate former service personnel. If they can afford to bung £1 billion to the DUP, they can afford a lifelong primary housing duty to all those who have been in care. Don't let the government off the hook for poverty in the UK by blaming refugees. We're better than that.